Back to this edition of Morning at 10 TV. It's the big story. My name is Simon Kasiati. Good morning, my lord.
Good morning, my brother. Good morning, viewers.
Well, I must make a correction there. You were elected in March of 2011 to serve a 5-year term as Lord Mayor of Kampala. You barely were in the office long enough to warm the seat and you were booted. Now you are back with gusto and bravado. Business as usual, what do you have up your sleeve? Let's start from there. Would you go back to City Hall, especially that padlocks are glaring at you?
Well, certainly if the people of Kampala have said the offices should be reopened and that I should occupy that office of the Lord Mayor, who can say no? If President Museveni and his team, the powers that be, do respect the will of the people, certainly they have no choice but to remove those padlocks you are talking about and to facilitate my office in accordance with the law. And then I resume the duties, because certainly it's unconstitutional to keep that office locked. It's equally a breach of the law for them to deny me access to that office, let alone freezing all the facilities that would accrue to that office.
Except that good, beautiful, personalized, number-plated car that I see you driving in lately.
It's now a Cassell of sorts.
I know you have run it down.
It's dilapidated.
But let's look at, away from the whole need to be in the office and all that, Elias, I think I need us now to shift the conversation to what you have up your sleeve in terms of deliverables for we, the citizens of Kampala. I mean, for the last 5 years, yes, we've seen your battles with the technical team of KCCA led by the good lady Jennifer Musisi. But we would love to get the confidence with regard to your plans in terms of tangible things that you want to do as Lord Mayor. What are going to be some of the areas you're going to have your fingers very firmly on?
To begin with, the question of reconstituting the governance structure is critical, is crucial. Many times you people tend to treat it as if it doesn't matter. You know, let's focus on service delivery. Forget about those governance issues as if they don't matter at all. But believe me, you, Simon, and the viewers there, there's no way you can talk of quality service delivery unless you have a vibrant, robust institution called KCCA. As of now, that institution is non-existent.
Why say so? I mean, we see beautiful branded cars, we see guys coming out, say I'm the spokesperson of KCCA, we see Jennifer Musisi superintending over city carnivals, we see some roads being painted with the tar, we see some street lights coming up, others going down, we see some hawkers running away for dear life because there's KCCA law enforcement officers. How do you say that body doesn't exist?
Yeah, there's what we call political grandstanding or posturing. That's what is happening in Kampala. You can see people pretending to be working in the name of KCCA, but within the meaning of the law, KCCA is not there. What do I mean? If you looked at the provisions of the authority, the KCCA Act, specifically Section 6, it spells out the composition of KCCA. The Lord Mayor, Deputy Lord Mayor, and the authority councillors. And then there are entities under KCCA. And it's that entire body that constitutes the governance structure in Kampala. That's what is called KCCA. In a nutshell, the elected leadership. As we talk right now, even those who claim to be there are just doing nothing. So you have no Lord Mayor in place because my office is locked. Neither do you have the Deputy Lord Mayor, and the councillors are redundant. Those who are exiting, they are outgoing. They have been redundant for the last 2 years. And of course, even the division urban councils. Well, the point I'm making here, we need to re-establish, reconstitute the governance structure.
How is
corporate
that going
governance
to be done?
Is important. How is it going to be done?
Especially given that you, as an individual, and the technical head Jennifer Musisi, as an individual, seem to have a lot of simmering bad blood between the two of you.
There is nothing personal.
Are you coming in with conciliatory approaches, or are you coming in with gusto and bravado of the people of Kampala right behind me?
It's always said it takes two to tango. Have you seen reciprocity on the other side? For starters, have you seen anyone from the government circles recognizing me as now elected, or even congratulating me?
Have you received a congratulatory letter?
Where? Nobody has congratulated me. not even the official government spokesperson to go on record that yes, we do extend a congratulatory message to the newly elected Lord Mayor. They don't need to recognize me as the existing one, much as the law says I'm still in office. But I know because of ego or something else, they may not do that. But at least to recognize that the will of the people has returned.
Maybe one would
as
say
the Lord
that
Mayor of Kampala.
One wrong done doesn't so. Make a right, that if they are not going that direction, you be yourself, put yourself in that situation and perhaps offer the olive branch. Let them reject it, but you will have heard it.
So where do you want me to issue that statement from?
Well, you're here on a public dais.
Oh my God, I'm here for a discussion, not to make the official communication in my capacity as the Lord Mayor. What we are doing right now is to thrash out some issues. But the issue is, let them reopen the office of the Lord Mayor, because even my term has not expired. Let them reinstate the office, actually. It should be.
So at least the current Lord Mayor can hand over to the newly elected Lord Mayor.
Exactly. I access the Lord Mayor's power. We go work out all the necessary modalities of ushering in a new government. Of course, they have, if you looked at the attrition rate, as far as councillors are concerned.
Oh, heavy. It's the mortality rate.
Just the mortality rate there.
Well, as pictures of your election day receipt of results where you are declared duly elected Lord Mayor play out on the screens, I would love to also put it back beyond the governance structure.
Yes.
There must be certain things that you also have in your eyes on. Like, for example, to expand the word governance, of course, we're talking about issues like, having a graft-free KCC, ensuring that service delivery does actually come and be realized by the people of Kampala. Roads are made better, more than what we are seeing at the moment. So what do you have as your priorities?
Number one, I've mentioned this time and again, it's the question of crafting a new plan, a new blueprint for Kampala.
Because at this point, are we still drafting? I thought this you had your ambit.
Oh, sure. It is not there. We used to have one which was prepared by the colonialists, and it was supposed to be reviewed every after 10 years.
Mm.
So we last reviewed it in 2004, and it was considered obsolete. It expired.
Absolutely.
So
and you didn't review it in 2014?
We didn't.
Because you were not in office.
I wasn't in office, and we needed not renew it because surely it was designed for a totally different generation. Our generation ought to have come up with a new one, and that's why we commissioned the consultants from Israel and South Africa, their own consultants.
Elias, you're speaking, and I thank you for holding this show in such high regard that you must speak from the clouds, but I'm now putting the questions to you as a Kampala resident who has now just seen a new mayor in Elias Rukago, who's been following the acrimonious relations you've had with KCCA.
Mm.
What do I stand to benefit from your presence at City Hall as the Lord Mayor? What am I going to see different from the old guard? What am I going to see different that's going to give me relief in the fact that possibly I voted right and had you there as my Lord Mayor?
First and foremost, to have your voice heard in all the policy-making processes. Because right now, there is no nexus between the leadership at KCCA and the people out there.
Mm.
So it's just a master-slave relationship. You wait for orders to come from State Hall, and you have to comply. Or if you question, you end up in the gallows. So, in jail. So that's the relationship. It's a master-slave relationship.
Mm-hmm.
But now, this governance structure I'm talking about, and you seem not to appreciate the full import of that, the significance.
Convince me. Sure. Because you see, like I told you, in the previous discussions we've discussed
the policy-making process hinges on that. There's no way your will, your aspirations will ever be reflected reflected in any of the policies running the city, unless you have directed the leadership in place. There is no way you are going to hold the accounting officers accountable
right
for their
there.
Omissions and commissions.
Right over there.
Yes.
Of course, accounting officers ought to be held accountable.
Yes.
What message are you sending to them? Are you saying you will have a zero tolerance? I'm just giving you an answer, but certainly one would want to see a new Lord Mayor that comes in to ensure that there is no bleeding of the coffers of the KCCA, who will ensure that when money is earmarked for a road, It is number one, the right amount as should be. Due process has been taken, that a proper contractor has been put in place through the proper governance structure of getting contracts through, and that a road that's supposed to be built over 1 year is built not in 6 years, but in the stipulated 1 year, perhaps even less. You know, that's the kind of talk we'd want maybe to hear from you, unless, of course, I'm missing the gun.
Basically, that is the point. That's the whole essence of having a functional institution called the KCCA with checks and balances. All its organs functioning normally in accordance with the law. And that's why during the tribunal proceedings, I mentioned that KCCA is suffering from multiple organ failure. Those institutions that are supposed to check the excesses of the accounting officers are non-existent. They are non-functional. Because right now, you don't have a functional public accounts committee. The powers are vested in the office of the Lord Mayor under Section 58 to appoint one. I executed my duties, but they are supposed to be ratified. The decision made by the Lord Mayor has to be vetted, ratified by the authority, and then
they implemented.
No, not implemented at that point. Of course, we have to forward the appointees to the minister in charge of Kampala for vetting. I did all that. The names were approved by the authority, and what was left was for the minister in charge of Kampala to vet them.
And that's never seen the light of day.
It never happened. So now you are supposed to get quarterly reports for public scrutiny. Not only you, the technical people, to scrutinize, I mean the members of the public accounts committee and the authority to scrutinize, but even members of the public. Mm. That is not there. You do not have a planning unit in place right now, because Section 21 and 22 talks of a Metropolitan Physical Planning Authority, and it's the minister to appoint 6 members. And myself, I'm supposed to represent the authority on that body. And we're supposed to come up with a plan, a comprehensive plan for the transformation of Kampala. First, the structure plan, but of course also a transport plan. Mm. Not only for Kampala alone, but even the metropolitan area, Wakiso, Mpiji, and the neighboring areas. Mm. So right now, you don't have any.
Why?
So for you, you are interested in mentioning specifics like that I'll do away with traffic jam, I'll help you get rid of the potholes, this.
Not drainage.
That. Drainage and so on. It's not about mentioning that. No.
It's
no.
A lot more that it's requires a lot,
exactly.
Proper deliberate planning.
I think proper that deliberate planning. And you cannot have a shortcut on that.
The issue of politics obviously will have to come into play, like it has done in the has been done in the past. The reason why you're going through these woos that you have suffered as Lord Mayor, elected in 2011, barely sat in your office, is because you probably do not ascribe to the political narrative of the ruling regime. Mm. That, of course, your expulsion and being expanded has not cowed you. Know, if in anything, it has emboldened you to remain with your divergent political views. Mm. What is your expectation that the relations and all this well-meaning good policy that you have up your sleeve will be received with glee, and you'll work well with whichever minister of Kampala will come in and the city will run smoothly? If that doesn't happen, what's your plan B? Because you cannot remain the Lord Mayor in absentia. You possibly have a better word to put it, but you cannot just be a Lord Mayor without your chains
in abeyance. Well, that's very, very unfortunate that for the last 2 years we have had that acrimonious relationship or situation. Mm. And I'm not about to plead guilty for whatever situation we are witnessing, we are contending with right now. Mm. Certainly, it is President Museveni and his team who are responsible for this. Why? He has always mentioned, in no uncertain terms, actually, he has been categorical, rather, on this, that look here, every electoral area that returns opposition politicians, not only the Lord Mayor or councillors or MPs, but
across the board,
if you bring opposition politicians,
you are doomed like him.
You will not benefit from government programs.
Doesn't that bother you as
and
Lord Mayor of
throughout
Kampala,
the campaigns,
who is thriving with a council that is largely opposition with all
so
the members of parliament from the five divisions of Kampala being opposition.
Exactly. This is the reason why I was saying the ball is in the court of President Yoweri Museveni. Is he about to undergo a paradigm shift of sorts or to change his attitude and realign his mindset to the new reality that indeed the people of Kampala want the opposition in charge of the city affairs, because they have not only elected the opposition leaning Lord Mayor, but 90% of the councillors are opposition, all the MPs are opposition, all the five mayors of division urban councils, for information, they are all opposition, and majority of the councillors at that level, they are all opposition. So what is he going to do with this body of elected leadership, all opposition affiliated leaning. To the, all opposition leaning? What is he going to do? Because he has already said, we are rats, all we want is to come and
so eat. So in other words, you, whatever yes. it is, you are emboldened in your stance and you say, well, let's wait for President Museveni to move his first pawn on this chessboard. But suffice to say, Elias, as we go through all this, your political work, as it were, I mean, you're a Lord Mayor now, but of course we've seen you as Lord Mayor, you've been involved in activism and political activity spanning across the country. I saw you in my home district of Rukunjiri. Those in Agulu have seen you. Those even in Karamoja have seen you.
Yes.
Countrywide, you
yes.
have been. Was it because of the times that we're in an election period, or this is what's going to be your standard modus operandi, that you'll be going places and places, supporting by elections here, going here and there, supporting a beleaguered local council chairperson, you know, things of that nature? How much political activism are you left to do now, even with this Herculean task of ensuring that the people who elected you receive proper service?
But Simon, you must appreciate we are faced with a national crisis, which calls for
national intervention.
Intervention, exactly, from all of us.
You're spreading yourself thin.
I'm telling you, no, spreading myself thin, because it's a call, it's a duty, it's a national, it's a constitutional command. Mm. If you looked at the provisions of Article 3, where there are situations of that nature, it's a duty for me to rise up. Today you are talking of Dr. Chiza Besigye being incarcerated in his home for over 30 days now. You are talking of General Sejusa is languishing in prison. This man from your home district, the general, is also crying foul that he was shot in the foot by Sujuyo on the command of the CDF.
Shot by crime preventers.
You see, the Right Honorable Mama Mbabazi is also facing it rough, and so on and so forth. So you can see a country which is not stable, a country which is has no, a structure that would ensure that there's continuity.
And like the priest said in one of our news stories, where the priest was saying us, man, you're going to offer yourself to die for all humankind. Your blood is not enough to cover all. And one would say, Elias, you're not going to be the magic bullet that's going to fix the malaise at Sejusa's home. I saw you are his lawyer. You're not going to be the magic bullet that's going to sort out that bullet in Tumukunde's leg. You're not going to be the magic bullet that's going to sort out Besigye's 30-day incarceration. You're not going to be the magic bullet that's going to sort out a problem in Kanunge, a problem in whatever. Why don't you concentrate and be that magic bullet that is going to sort out the malaise of the situation in Kampala as your nucleus? And then, so that we of Kampala don't feel that we are offended by our good Lord Mayor, who rather than attend to our needs, residual needs, is out trying to liberate an entire country.
You see, you're talking of concentrating in Kampala here. Is everything okay in Kampala? You can see the heavy deployment,
like
Kololo is almost a barracks. You've seen
like
all the junctions in Kampala, it's the same story. And
that's why we say,
even with the finances,
the
finances I would need to fix the problems in Kampala. You have to get from the consolidated fund. You've had the stories, the 34 billion is missing in Bank of Uganda, 27 billion is gone. So where would the money come from to fix the problems of Kampala? So you cannot isolate these issues of Kampala from the national crisis we are faced with. Mm. So holistically, we have to address the crisis we are facing as a nation. And that's why I'm requesting you, Simon, don't also focus your attention on this morning show only at NETV here. Mm. You have a duty under the Constitution to spare some time, address your minds to the crisis we are faced with as a nation, make your contribution.
I have a brother who is standing for, as a Lord Councillor in one of the divisions of Kampala. You know that for a fact. And after here, I want to have a conversation with you. So that when you bring that boy into the chambers of KCC as one of your councillors, certainly in marching. Yes, you will be very sure that I will also have my voice in there because he listens to me as his younger brother. But suffice as we conclude, at a very personal level, and let's even act a bit gossipy. When was the last time you received a phone call from Jennifer Musisi?
Why would I receive one?
I will ask you the rationale of her calling. That's why I will ask her why she would call you. But when was the last time you received a phone call from her? Well, if at all?
To the best of my recollection, I think it was way back in 2012.
When was the last time you met, like a meeting with you, like, you know, face to face?
Face to face?
That famous picture when she was putting the robe around you? And swearing in?
No. Subsequently, we had, by the way, I had fruitful meetings, even between us in at State Hall in our office, and even the authority meetings, we would meet, we would interact, we would exchange.
So you've only met in that restricted official setting at KCCA in the course of your work?
Certainly.
The Honorable Frank Tumwebaze. The Honorable Frank Tumwebaze, when is the time he called you?
I can't recall, honestly.
When was the last time you and him met?
No, I used to go to his office here, at the president's office, quite often here in Kampala.
And he accorded you audience and you spoke? And
We would meet together with the mayors of division urban councils, and of course, we would interact and interface with him, put on table quite a number of issues. Unfortunately, he seemed not to have enough time to address the concerns we were raising.
When was the last time?
And at one time, he left us in his office and went to see. He went away, he said he would come and, oh my God. Anyway.
That's conversation for another day. That's but of course, it speaks day. Into the kind of respect he held for if at all.
But I hold him in high esteem.
When was the last time you picked up your phone and tried to call Jennifer Musisi, if at all you have her number?
For what reason, honestly?
That's the olive branch I'm talking about, reaching out.
For what? For what reason? Because the office is locked, as we talk right now. So why would I call her?
So these conversations and acrimonious relations were playing out largely in a stage where there was no interpersonal connectivity. Or did you have emissaries that you sent to each other, that you maybe sent to each other? Does she receive messages?
For the first 3 years at State Hall, honestly speaking, we were on talking terms, and we would exchange communications, only that when it came to matters of accountability, that's where we had a problem, insisting on the reports of the contracts committee. We are saying, I will not supposed to interfere, because mine is eyes on, hands off. But likewise, this committee is also supposed to be independent of our office. They are supposed to do
be
their
eyes
work.
On, hands on.
Yes, certainly. And then under Section 66, they are supposed to give us quarterly reports to any of us, do our work of monitoring, of oversight, and so on and so forth. But all these were denied to us. She created a barricade there and said, no way, a Berlin wall of sorts, that this is a no-go area for you. And that complicated matters, because how would I continue doing my work if you have denied me that crucial information?
Elias, obviously, conversation between you and the big story will continue, and obviously, even before you take office in terms of swearing in, we'll have had you here to converse, especially about your first 100 days. There is our preliminary discussion after your election as Lord Mayor, and I know that you are quite a very amiable gentleman when it comes to honoring our invitations, and we extend the next invitation to come here at least next month, so we can have you monthly to share with us what your plans and your dispositions, and of course,
and the specifics you people want to talk about, floods, traffic jam, things to do with the congestion, trade order, you know, those issues you always want.
That's why I've deliberately left out my question on vendors and the presence
exactly
of the
I know
of
you
Kampala,
want us to go into
but
those,
certainly
the
conversation
specifics
will continue.
Yeah, sure.
For the viewers, it's been a pleasure holding forth with you and having you stay tuned to this conversation between I and the Lord Mayor of Kampala, Elias Olukwago, who obviously has spoken a bit of this and that, but very specifically telling you that the situation that he's faced with requires a national approach.
It's dire.
It's dire. Insurmountable. He wants to use those words, and oftentimes he gets it really right on the head. And so the conversation will obviously continue for about now. Let's take a breather. When we return, it's Everyday Alive with Brian Mulondo, but I'm thankful that after that there will be more quality programming with the sports and then more CMTS. Stay with us.